Hey everyone, and welcome to the OC Show, Season 2, Episode 11. I'm Truffman, and this is Timothée Tiala.
Hi Truff, what's up?
I'm doing good. I had to wake up this morning a bit earlier because we didn't have the complete setup in the new office to be ready for this show, but Now everything is fine.
Well, new office, for which you can see there's still a little bit of echo and things, because actually the studio is right behind us, but it's not completely finished yet.
It would actually sound worse inside the studio right now rather than here.
Yes, so we still have to soundproof that, but I think for today we can just do it here. It's going to be fine.
Today, 11th episode, a lot of stuff to talk about. You guys just saw the recording we posted on our YouTube channel just a few days ago. And for this special episode, we're going to have a guest, one of your long-time guests, Dennis Garcia. Hi, Dennis.
Hi. Thanks for having me back.
Always a pleasure. You were here in Taiwan a few days ago, actually last week, if I'm right.
Yep. And I was there until the 10th, actually. So.
And we're going to be talking about Computex and what happened during all that time. Timothée, do you want to remind what we're going to see all today?
We have three main topics for today. First of all, Computex. That's the wrong topic sheet.
Oops, that's not the right one.
That's the one from last week. It doesn't matter. So we have Computex. Mainly, we'll talk with Dennis about that because he had really more time than us to work around the show. And then we'll talk about the g.skill OC World Cup, which was the biggest competition on the trade show on the floor. So there we had a competition, world record stage, so we're going to talk a little bit about that. Then we had the World Tour Asia event, which was quite successful, quite big and quite awesome, and also quite tiring for us, but it was great. So we need to mention that, and we'll show you a little bit more footage about it. And then we will announce finally the giveaway, the winner of the BSOD contest.
It's a blue screen contest that was running for like a few weeks, and it's been like a week and a half that we are saying like, we're gonna announce it.
Every time we pushed it back because there was no time, and we did something else, and there's another thing, and then it was the World Tour, and there was the Computex, and there was
too many things.
And then moving office, and
the office moving was like one of the big highlights for us, especially because this one is much, much bigger.
It was a highlight done in 2 days, so it was not too bad. So, yeah.
So, first, Computex 2015.
Yeah. So Computex, that's the biggest trade show of the year in terms of tech, not consumer product only. So, which is, I think, for me, it's my most favorite show today. Like CES is nice, but CES, you don't really see all the small gadgets and all the, you don't see the boards behind the actual final product. So CES is really the final TV, the final computer, the final.
CES is too much consumer. Like it's really the home appliances, the TVs, and so on.
Sure.
Cebit, there's nothing anymore there. Pretty much, like everything is dead. It's like in between two quarters, so it's nothing really new to happen. And Computex, the last one of the year, so everything that's gonna happen in the next 6 months have been displayed or talked about or leaked or rumored. Anyway, there's a lot of stuff to talk about, and that's why we have Dennis with us today.
So Dennis, you had time to walk around the trade show. What were your expectations before, and what did you saw that was interesting?
Okay, well, let's see. Expectations before going to the show, this is something we talked about a couple episodes ago, I believe. I wanted to see the new Skylake motherboards. You know, those should have been on display, which they were. There was also a rumor of a new GPU, which turned out to actually be true. We have the GTX 980 Ti, which is an awesome GPU. We also had, a whole lot of gaming peripherals. So there was a lot of new keyboards and mice and stuff like that. Several new cases. So we had at InWin, for instance, they had the H stand or H tower or H frame or something had an H in it, but it was really cool because it was controlled from your mobile device, so you could connect to the device and say, okay, I want to open it up, and it's going to show these lasers as a proximity, and that's how much the case would open up, and then you could press a button and it would open up kind of like a lotus flower.
Was that the one that does like look like a transformer, like completely opening up and just getting outside?
Yep, that was pretty much it. So yeah, it would open up and then expose the motherboard and video cards and all that stuff, and then you could tilt that tray so you could position it any way you wanted. Cool. It was honestly, it was probably one of the coolest little displays I had seen at Computex over the past however many times I've gone. Let's see, Rocket had a really cool mouse. I think you guys went and saw Rocket. But it was like a Razer mouse, so it had a whole bunch of MMO buttons on the side.
Oh, and the one you can unmount completely, right? Left and right and add stuff.
Yep.
Yeah, actually, and we did pass by. We did expect to be able to change from one hand to the other hand.
I thought you could at the beginning change him from left-handed to right-handed, but you could not connect the other side. It was not working. So you could only add more buttons.
Yeah. Well, then you could also configure the buttons. So you can say, well, I want four buttons across the top, and then the middle section is no buttons at all, and then you could blank that area out completely, and then maybe two buttons at the bottom with the center piece blanked out as well. So at that point you could grab the mouse and move it around and then still have a bunch of buttons on there. It was customizable, so you could change the dexterity. And then in the software, they finally integrated everything, so you could talk to the ISCU and the cone, which are the keyboard and the mouse, and then connect that with a mobile device so you could see your game stats and stuff like that, which is, you know, something that they did several years ago, but it's all in one software package now.
Yeah. Also, Trifon is showing now the pictures.
I'm actually
on the
Hardware Asylum, on your website, hardwareasylum.com, and I'm actually showing up the mice. It's actually crazy, like, right now, like, the hardware doesn't evolve that much anymore, but just the software around it is just getting crazy.
Yeah, and that's really the bulk of the new stuff, for instance. One company I didn't write anything about was Ace Store, which is an ASUS company. They build NAS devices, and they have some really amazing hardware in the NAS, but they don't talk about that so much. It's all about what the NAS can do for you. So it's talking about the software and the multimedia capabilities of it, and how I can BitTorrent files and then serve them up over a mobile device, over the internet and stuff like that.
Oh,
it's
so like
cool.
More the end user experience, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's interesting, and that's, that the Taiwanese companies start to focus more on that than the usual hardware number one to have this feature first, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, and that's a response of hardware getting boring, so to speak, where, you know, the capabilities of a motherboard aren't, you know, they don't last 6 months anymore. They last like 5 years. So the you don't need to have the latest and greatest hardware anymore. So what do you do with the new hardware that you can buy? For instance, like MSI had a new X99 gaming motherboard that had an amazing little light show on it.
I think
yeah.
We did post
a
video on our Instagram,
you can
right?
Check on the Instagram, on the OCTV Instagram, I think. Yeah, it had like a beaming light, and you had a tablet application, right, to change all the LEDs. And
yeah, and you can change the color to anything you wanted and change different regions of it. Gigabyte also had a motherboard that should do the same thing, although it wasn't an X99, it was one of the new Z170s. Mm-hmm. And that's their new G1 gaming line, which is red,
the white, and
black.
Red one, right?
Well, we do actually have the video about the Godlike Gaming from MSI, with all the LED flashing all around. I hope there's no sound on it.
There's the sound.
As you can see, it's flashing from everywhere. You can have it flashing, you can have it like a rainbow style. It's all RGB. That was like one of the keywords of the Computex again this year, like gaming and RGB.
Yep. Yeah, well, and that portion of the show is not going to go away anytime soon, because that's going to be the future of, you know, the I'm going to call it the turning hardware into a peacock.
Yeah.
So, and then, of course, the GTX 980 Ti was a big news. That was an announcement right before the show. The first vendor I saw was EVGA, and they had an entire line of 980 Ti's, all the way from the reference design to hot clock versions to their famed classified edition, and then up to the classified kingpin
right.
edition, which... All of them have the same ACX cooler that they've pioneered for the past several years, but the new Kingpin edition, instead of having aluminum and copper pieces, they copper plated the entire thing.
Yeah.
and you have a picture of it.
Those are pretty cool. I think also Zotac had quite a lot of.
Yeah, Zotac had like
a huge selection. They had like five or six
different SKUs. Yeah.
Yeah.
So they had the regular one, they had the reference design, they have the special design, they have the ACS cooling one, they have the extreme one, and they had the extreme, super extreme, whatever, which was the version like was
with
the
crazy
painting.
Thick back plate of like 10 centimeters,
and a huge
5 millimeters of steel at the back. It was pretty massive.
Yeah, Zotac had. I think it was 5 different SKUs or 4 different versions. A couple of them were the same card, basically, but they just changed the cooler on it. The Extreme that you were talking about has the custom PCB, and then there's the Extreme Omega or something.
Yeah,
crazy
Omega.
Like that.
Yeah, I got lost at that point in the references. I was like, what?
Yeah, they...
Come on, make it
I never quite understood the Zotac naming. It never made too much sense to me, but...
But even on the 980 Ti, like the number of SKU they have is just insane. Like 6 different product for the exact same card. So that's actually like,
well, the only difference is slightly in clock, and that's it.
Yeah.
So I guess it all depends how much money you want to put in your card.
Yeah. I kind of like the push the limits thing they have in the background. I mean, for the one that knows us, we always have like keep pushing it. So.
Yeah. They're playing into the whole overclocking thing really well at Zotac. So hopefully they will start selling more products in the States instead of in South America.
True, they were focusing a lot South America, and that's right.
Yeah, it's very regionalized, and they're very competitive there. And I think that's one reason they concentrate on it. So, but yeah, other than that, I mean, I went to MSI looking for a Lightning card, and all they had was a gaming card. Gigabyte had a 980 Ti gaming that was color matched to the new motherboard.
Well, actually, talking about Gigabyte, we found something that was quite surprising. If you see the picture of the G1, that the upcoming gaming motherboard on Z170 chipset, and if you look at the colorful, I think I just closed the Instagram for it. And if you look at colorful, so this one you see on the screen is colorful, so that's one of the main OEM in China. So it's like black, red, and white, and you look at the Gigabyte one, it looks almost the same.
Yeah, besides that, you see Express slots that are like red with the metallic stuff. Yeah, very similar actually.
It's very similar. So I don't know who choose to have like the white backplate or the white cover on it, because everyone was having cover. Of
course.
It
has water cooling plugs, right?
Yeah. Well, that's I want to say that's something that EVGA kind of pioneered, and then everybody else adopted. So it, you know, as you know, the one company will come out with something really, really cool, and then the next year everybody does the same thing. Right. Unless, of course, the manufacturer of the PCB goes and leaks something to somebody. It's like, oh, well, they're doing this channel where you can separate the audio. It's like everybody does that.
Yeah.
You know, I talked. I talked with Gigabyte because the first day that I went to go see them, they couldn't show the new G1 motherboard. So I had to go back after the show and take a look at it. And so we were kind of talking about the different features on the board and how a lot of it was very similar to what I saw on the Godlike board at MSI. And they said, well,
all those boards are very similar. So maybe it's because it's too early yet. Like none of the boards are nowhere near final anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and all of this stuff is just, based on when Skylake's supposed to come out, which is the Z70 or 170 chipset processor combo, right? Based on when that comes out, if we had moved it to the springtime, then all the boards we saw would be like CBIT quality motherboards. So, we won't see anything come out until like later this year. And that will be when final designs come out and whether or not those metal straps around the PCI Express slots will stay there. And,
that was like one big thing, like reinforced PCI Express slots and RGB motherboard. That was the two main highlights of Computex, if you think about that. And of course, the extreme naming, gaming, godlike naming chain for the product.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's all who's going to have the biggest name. But I think for us, we're going to have to still wait until launch for seeing the Z170 overclocking boards.
Yeah. So the last item that I really wanted to mention was something that I thought was probably the coolest thing I saw at Computex, and it was called the cat feed, or basically cat feeder. It is a an automated cat feeder. Has food and water with facial recognition. So your cat, you can program your cat in there, the camera will recognize the face and then track how much the cat weighs, how long they sat there eating, how much food they ate, whether or not they're on a diet, and how much food to dispense. And then if you have more than one cat, it will track each one of those cats. It's pretty darn cool.
Is that the cat fi or something?
Yeah, the cat fi.
Yeah,
I did a post on that one earlier, but it's it was in Hall 3, and it was based off of a startup. There was a whole bunch of startups in there. There were, one of them was doing like LED lighting and humidity monitoring for.
It looks almost like a coffee grounder.
Yeah, a little bit.
Okay, so you have one side for the food and the other side for the water, and once the cats get in,
he's trapped.
Well, he's not really trapped, but yeah, once they go up there, then the feeder will go and recognize their face, and then it will track everything for you and send it to your mobile phone so you can monitor how much they're eating, how long they've been there, and stuff like that. You can also track if the cat hasn't been by in a while to eat, whether or not they're getting heavy or not heavy.
You're too fat. No more food for you. You're on the diet for the next 3 days.
Yeah. You know, I was looking at this and it's like, well, you know, this is kind of like, you know, CSI for pets, but it's one of those, cats are one of the, I should say they're notorious for not letting their owners know if they're having health problems. They hide their illnesses very, very well. But if they come in here and, you know, you notice that across the chart that they're losing weight, or that they're gaining weight, but they're not eating any food, well, maybe they're getting food from somewhere else, or they have, you know, a health problem you need to address. So it's kind of fun.
Yeah, it's cool. And well, that's the cool things actually like about Computex, right? That stuff you don't really see anywhere else.
Yeah. Well, this is this would be a device that you would see at CES, not necessarily Computex, but it's true. A Taiwan. It made sense.
Timothée, what was your highlight for the Computex show?
So I didn't really have so much time to walk around. I think it was way too much USB cables. So seriously,
USB type is gonna be the fastest to be by everyone.
There should be a ban on USB cables and USB charger or battery packs. I mean, seriously, this is not technology for, you know, it's what you find in your supermarket. There's not really any point to have it there. Now, what was cool, I think it was like some small drives for doing RAID on SSDs and things like that that you can carry with you, like literally. Like usually we have those RAID drives which usually are like 3.5 inch. So you have to plug them and you need external power. It's not really convenient. So there was this one company that had one for 2.5 inches. You could plug it directly USB 3, I think, or powered by the USB. So that was really cool. So I think that was the most interesting thing I saw. I liked also the huge modding desk from, what was the name of the company?
Lanoxia from Germany.
Really, really huge desk. I have no idea how they brought that over there, but that was really cool. And I think actually a lot more modding this year, which was interesting. I liked what Kuda Master was doing. That was very nice as well.
So having like a special like a maker kind of booth.
Yeah, it was kind of creative and different from what everyone else was doing. So I guess they should get the praises for that. That's really good.
On my side, I really like the Steam Box from Zotac.
Actually, you want one, right?
I want one. Yeah, I want one. They had the special Steam Box, like the one with the logo and everything, and they had the black version. I think that Dennis, you posted some picture of the black gaming console and PC.
They had two of them. The one with the logo on it was it came with SteamOS and all the hardware. The black one was more gaming centric that you bought as a bare bone system. Yeah, so you had to put your own OS on there.
Well, both look extremely nice. They look cool. There was some mock-up before when actually Valve was announcing that they were making a Steam Box. But yeah, I do actually really like this one. I got the picture here. So that's the black one you can see, and they that will fit nicely in a living room. of course.
Yeah. In terms of hardware, it's just running Broadwell, so it's all mobile based, but plenty of power to run anything on Steam right now.
Yeah, especially unless you play GTA 4K or something, it's like not really necessary.
Yeah.
Below all that, we had a lot of highlight for Computex, especially on the overclocking side. There was a lot of overclocking going on, especially at the g.skill OC World Cup. They had like three different stuff happening at the same time. They had the World Cup, they had the OC stage, and they had some local like g.skill overclocker benching with them. So basically, there was the World Cup for something to grab up to 10k for the winner.
Yeah, there was 10k for the winner. 10k for the winner, and then a little bit money down for the other places. And I think for the record, there was also some rewards for the records broken, pretty much. So a lot of companies were involved in that because since g.skill doesn't manufacture motherboards. For them, it was it's quite convenient to provide a memory or get the brands to compete on their memory on the booth, and then you have all the competitors from the motherboard industry coming and going there, and they reserve every day a different day for each brand. So it means they're not really in direct competition. Besides, when there's the World Cup, right?
But the World Cup is more like the overclockers competing.
Yeah, the show is about the overclocker.
Yeah, the show is about the overclocker, not the manufacturer.
The overclocker and the g.skill memory, and not so much about the motherboard, especially when you do overclocking like this on the stage, you couldn't really see the board that much. There was some kind of wall, and it was really high up.
Even like a Locking Lamb that won the OC World Cup, it was insulating everything with like rice, like bag of rice.
You couldn't see
just
the motherboard.
You could not see the motherboard anymore. And he was using the ASRock one, and he was actually painting it in white. So that was not even the right color for the motherboard. So.
Yeah, so that went pretty well, actually. There, a lot of people were passing around because it's the smoke, and I think now they have a much more central place on the trade show. They used to be very close to the door, and now they're much more in the center, so which means they're not so more next to the exit than before. So people, you pass by a lot more. It's like a big avenue, and they were just at a crossing. So a lot of people were just, you know, passing by and checking it out. I guess it's a lot for the smoke, more than the actual overclocking, because there was no way to actually see what was going on. The only way you could follow the competition was through the OC Esports website, if you had the ranking on your phone. So I was just checking once in a while, you know, while I was at the trade show. But if you were passing by the booth, like, you only have the result, the ranking table, and the time left for the competition, so for the different rounds. So it was a bit hard to follow, I think, for the regular visitor that would pass by. He would not understand.
Usually people will go pass by, stop because there's LN2 smoke.
Yeah, and the booth babes
and the booth
presenting
babe.
The products and stuff. So yeah.
Yeah, every time I passed by there, nobody was doing anything.
That's kind of the issue with the overclocking, like when you bench in like on a public space like this, you need to have something timed and really like stick to the plan and organize. Otherwise, just like we call that like monkey benching, if you can say.
If you go for the records as well, it takes a lot more time to prepare, you know. So this, you spend more time preparing than actually getting the score out. So it's like it takes some time, and there's indeed, like you say, Dennis, you pass by and there's nothing going on.
Yeah.
Don't forget, guys, you're still monitoring the live chat on Twitch. There is a I Heard Truth. And although anyway, and Naughty Miroku, thanks guys for being here. Don't forget, we are still always watching what's going on. And welcome Kunasty, although at the same time. So OC World Cup, that was won by Locking Lamb from Hong Kong, HKETC laboratory teams, if we can say. And that was the world record stage, so that's actually something we can still see on the screen with Elmore and TL from East that were benching there.
Yeah.
So as we say, there was the World Cup, so 10k for the winner, so...
quite a big cash prize, actually, the biggest cash prize on Computex.
Biggest cash prize ever for like a single person for a competition,
same as last year.
And on the world record stage, they were like benching, and as you say, like most of the manufacturers came and had some time, like one day, to just show off whatever they want on the show. So there was, like you say, MSI, S02E11, S-Rock, Gigabyte, like all the guys came and did something at the booth at that time.
Yeah.
Timothée?
Yeah.
What was your highlight about the OC World Cup?
So for me, I really didn't have much time to go around. So every time I went there, it was at the end of the day, pretty much 5:30 when they were packing. So my only highlight is to talk to the guys right after the competition, after the rounds. And it seemed from the discussion that it was pretty intense, actually. So the 2 hours format, it works pretty well, I think, for what they were expected to do during those 2 hours. Especially the selection of the benchmarks, the time they had, preparation, especially if you consider you had on top, you know, it's Computex, so at night you're not sleeping much. During the day it's very noisy and you're preparing in the noisy environment. Then you have to bench on stage, you have to focus, people passing by, maybe sometimes asking questions, you know. So I think, yeah, the guys seem to be quite exhausted, but happy.
Yeah. Well, that's good if everyone enjoyed that.
Sure.
Dennis, if you had to sum up Computex in maybe 3 words, what would that be?
3 words. Hot, sweaty, fun. There
well,
we go.
I was asking the question because there was actually more and more people that were like from the press, that people that we meet at the parties and so on, that say, "Oh, Computex is getting boring. Oh, it's getting boring," and so on. Like, it's not boring, it's just changing. Like, there was, except the 980 Ti, there was no extremely new announcement in terms of hardware that would drive the complete market to something else. For example, Intel, that didn't release the Skylake CPU during Computex, they would release that later this year, supposedly. So they were just like showing the motherboard, but nothing, you could not talk more about all that. So that's why a lot of people say it was boring. On our side, I think there was a lot more overclockers than ever before.
Yes,
and it's getting like the overclocker meetup week, if you can say.
Yeah, it's the pilgrimage of the overclocker, isn't it? Everyone comes here to meet the others, to have a chat, talk a lot with the vendors. I think it's mainly becoming a networking event for overclockers and the industry. Because Cebit is no more here, actually. A lot of overclockers used to go to Cebit to talk to the motherboard manufacturers, but since there's no one anymore going to Cebit, they all have to come here.
I said that Intel didn't launch any new CPU. That's not exactly true, because they launched the Broadwell CPU for desktop. That was the Core M. The Core M is the one for the laptop and the notebooks. That was launched during CES time. Oh, yeah, CES time?
Yeah.
Or just before? Well,
yeah,
that was like a few months ago.
Yeah.
And they did exactly the same package, but they put that on like a retail desktop motherboard, like Z97 will work. And we had the chance to test it when we went to the Intel room. And overclocking-wise, we're kind of stuck at 4.2 GHz. We got the explanation and on the background by some of the Intel people saying that's because it's a mobile architecture and not that many settings to do the overclocking. But what we want is we wait for Skylake, because Skylake is going to be great. I'm sure that's going to be fun. I'm sure we're going to have a lot of things to do with it. We still have to get samples first, test how the things goes, see how fast the motherboard manufacturer will be able to get the BIOS ready.
Yeah.
Because that's always the same, the same trick, like, new CPU, new chipsets, but then it's like, you need to wait like 4 weeks to have the BIOS working completely. For the past 5 years, that's getting faster and faster. Usually we end up like day one of launch, everything is working, perfectly or almost perfectly. But we're gonna have to wait for that.
All right.
Tim, what's the next major overclocking event that was happening during Computex?
Well, everyone knows, the Asia Bot World Tour 2015, sorry. So that was the Asia stop, that was the last stop that was planned this year for the moment. Pretty popular among overclockers, about 24 overclockers bought tickets to bench at the events, and then a few more were just, hanging around. For some of them, it was already too much benching after a whole week, of overclocking. Some of them were even here before, and some others were, still walking around HQs and different things like that. So in the end, like I would say about 30 overclockers passed by and were at the event, and then we had like about 60 visitors coming, you know, so people from
the industry, people that were staying there for the weekend, usually people just
press,
a little bit more.
A bit of everything, yeah. Mm-hmm. So it was very nice. It was quite relaxed, exactly the atmosphere expected. So there we had like three main things, the gathering, so the bench party pretty much. And then we had the World Series, which is the competition organized by HWBot, and we had the ROG OC Showdown area.
So that was like three things happening at the same time. So we do that a lot. Like the World Tour, people can come with whatever they want, bench there. The World Series organized by HWBot, that was exactly the same concept as the one in America, as the one in Europe and here. And the ROG Showdown that was sponsored by Eze, CyberX, and Seasonic.
Yes.
So it turned out that out of the all the people that bought the tickets, we had 22 overclockers competing in the World Series.
Yep.
And Lukinen finished first.
Actually, it was the Indonesian guys pushed really hard on this event. If you look like in the top 10, they have like four guys. So it's really, really strong team, and the Jagat guys were really, really into the World Series competition. So like Lucky Noob finished first, B-Boy Chase finished second, and then we had Bruno third and Dr. Wings fourth. So quite a nice lineup for the winning, and I think the guys were really happy with the competition. I think Lucky Noob walked away with like 2,000 something.
Yeah. B-Boy Chase was like over 1,000 USD too.
And Bruno 560.
And Bruno 560, yeah. So that was actually the first official HWBot World Series that had cash prize to it. I think people liked it.
Yeah.
We're not to the amount of cash prize as g.skill is throwing to the
It's a different concept, you know.
But it's
like
a completely different concept. People mostly came to the World Tour to share the knowledge, to share their overclocking results, to make sure that you know they can, you know, get in touch with all the overclockers around the world. Computex, that's always a time of the year that we all gather together in one same city, so it's always good to have that. Talking about the scores of Lucky Noob, it's funny because it did the first stage that was Super Pi.
Yeah.
It did that with the G3258, so that's a very, you know, cheap and used TPU. That was based on hardware points, so the more people competing on that, if you get a good score, you're going to get a better, like, wear points to it. And then he used, for the two other stage, he used the Core i7, the 5960X, mm-hmm, on X99 motherboard. So that was it. Actually, that's funny to see Lucky Noob first and B-Boy Chase, this Padawan, being second for that. I think they're actually having a good team and I'm going to say that, like a good team and a good spirit in between them. They always bench together. I think they have the same mind for benching, the same, yeah, way of benching. And Bruno, first time live event. The guy is overclocking for 10 months. He was being first of Romania just a few weeks, like just a week before Computex.
Yeah.
And turned out that first competition, first show up at live event, benching with the stress and everything, still managed to compete in the World Series and finish third.
But he might have actually finished more if he had a second stage completed, because he didn't submit anything in,
yep,
the second stage. So
that's actually interesting, because he spent a lot of time on the OC Showdown area.
Yeah.
He spent almost the first day. He spent only benching for the OC Showdown area. That was like a target of global hardware, global first place, and world record scores. And yeah, actually, he turned out to be quite impressive. I mean, in one stage three, I mean, he had the best score in stage three, so
yeah,
like the full out signing bench.
That was really good, because he didn't really brought any hardware to the event. He was mainly benching with what was provided. So for sure, for the Super Pi stage, the hardware points, he couldn't do much there. But for the rest, he did pretty well. And then I guess for the graphics cards, with the provided 980 Ti's, it was a little bit too strong to reach the actual target that was peaked. So even if you were downclocking and running slow-mo and running Super Pi or double prime at the same time you were running the 3D benchmark, you were still too strong. So yeah. Dennis, did you have the time to pass by?
I stopped by for probably about a half hour on Saturday. Mm-hmm. That was after Computex. And it was, people were still funneling in, so there wasn't a lot going on. Unfortunately, I had other things I had to do, so I couldn't come back. But yeah, I did stop by. I was there in spirit.
Yeah. What did you think about the event, like the way it was set up and the animation there?
Well, as you know, I was there last year, and I spent a lot of time at the Maker Bar checking that event out. I think the layout was really similar to the way it was last year. So, I mean, from that standpoint, it was probably good. I liked how you guys set up an actual area to broadcast. So,
you
had your own backdrop.
Last year.
With the super perfectly designed background.
Sure. But you had lights in there, that was good, so you could actually illuminate yourself. I believe Albert was on stream almost all the time when you guys were off doing other things, so that was pretty cool. And then, what was it, you had the other section of the Maker Bar for demonstrations, I believe.
Yeah, for the ROG.
That's where
where
the ROG wall was set up and everything, so... really liked the venue. I mean, it was set up a lot nicer than it was the previous year. But the previous year was set more as like a party, not necessarily as an event. So,
last year was just a gathering. Was just like, hey, we have this space, we have this amount of talent, you just come over and do whatever you want there.
It was a celebration for the 10 years of HI touring.
Yeah.
Well,
so you know, a different event, different venue. That's it reflects well. And you know, I personally, I kind of like the gathering approach versus, you know, a formal event approach. But, you know, I didn't bench either, so I can't really say much.
Talking about the stream, we had a lot of people on the stream. We had a lot of giveaway on the stream, too. We will not announce the winner of the giveaway in this show. We are doing the blue screen contest announcement here. We'll maybe announce something later concerning the special big giveaway that we were running on our Facebook fan page until yesterday evening. Mm-hmm. Still have to check all the entries if everything is fine, and then I'm gonna announce the winner for that one. Maybe the next OC show, maybe a special OC show for it. We don't know yet. Who will see? Who knows? Depends if we have the studio in time.
Yeah.
And Timothy, for you, what was the highlight of the world tour?
So I really actually liked the gathering part in the World Series competition, because it was like, you know, it has this kind of friendly atmosphere where people like bench with each other and share hardware. And for example, how the Indonesian guys were benching together, or even how Sisolio and Vivi and Dr. Weiss were benching next to each other, you know. And that's the whole point, you know, exchanging tweaks across the table and hey, did you do that? That's really what I think is the most important about that kind of event.
There's people trolling on the live chat.
True, there's always
especially High Hertz Proof. I don't know who's behind that. I guess it's some of our friends that we saw last weekend.
A secret fan of you, true.
Secret fan of myself? Oh, I don't think so. Yeah, it was funny for the world show, like you said, like everyone was benching together and making sure everything was working fine and so on. I'm still impressed by the Indonesian guys. I have to be honest, like these guys put like a full out event like performance. They won the HW World Series and they were cleaning their desk so well that on Sunday evening, so the event was Saturday, Sunday and Monday. And on Sunday evening, they cleaned so well the desk that we saw they already left. We just had to look below the table to see that the luggage was still there to find out that, oh yeah, they're going to come back tomorrow. So, congratulations, guys. You won the World Series, but you also won our respect for cleaning your desk.
We should next year have some funny awards, like the awards of the cleanest desk.
The messiest one.
The most messiest desk, or something like this, you know, some random stuff. Or like the award of Mr. Vaseline, or something like this. That would be hilarious to have. You know, you just make a ceremony about it, and you should make it very seriously.
And the award for the messiest desk of this World Tour is...
Or the biggest fail of Computex is, in terms of overclocking...
Eight back!
But yes, that would be hilarious. Some guys would not like it, but I guess... the point is to have fun with it.
Indeed. There was also some special hardware that we had during the event. We had the 980 Ti Strix, we had the complete cooling and so on, so that was displayed during Computex, but we were the only one to not be able to touch it and just show it around.
Yeah, I think the guys at the event were the very first ones to actually have the chance to play with the card, so that was also one of the highlights, I think.
I think a lot of the guys enjoy that.
Yeah.
Even if the card is not yet, ready to go on the market, ASUS is still working on it. But so far, like being able to test with like a liquid nitrogen and everything, a card that is not even available on the market is something that not always special. You always feel a little bit special when you do that and not have to go to the HQ to find out what was going on and so on. As on the screen, you can see we had the guys from India, Tullius and Cloud7. Big shout out to you guys because you deserve it. You were over enthusiastic, you did help a lot. We highly appreciate that. And we had a nice couch chat interview. I don't know how we can't remember how we called that video. And it was a nice chat. I mean, the guys from India were like, oh, yeah, no, it's fun to see everyone. That's the first time we come here. If you guys want to rewatch the complete, I think it was like 45 minutes of discussions, like what they do in life, why they came here, what was the purpose of the trip, because they came just for the world tour.
Very
they didn't even came for Computex.
Very enthusiastic, and I think we will see them more and more in events all around, for sure.
And actually, Tullius finished fifth on the World Series too, so that was
they were benching together, both Cloud7 and Tullius.
So if you want to rewatch the discussion that we had with them, you can just go to youtube.com/overclocking-tv and you can find all the videos actually from Computex, like all the small updates, like the, we call that the OC updates, not the OC update for the website on HWBot, otherwise Maxman is going to broke everything again, but the OC update from the overclockers at the Computex, like on the shows and so on, as well as all the videos from the World Series. We can expect to have the after movie quite soon.
Yeah, I'm gonna work on that this week.
So quite soon, stay tuned, we're gonna have the after movie of the World Series. We're gonna have some more surprise for you guys in the next few weeks and months. We did shoot a lot of videos. I hope we can make good use of them. And that will actually be interesting to see what we can come up with.
Yeah, so time to wrap up. But before we do that, we need to announce who is the winner of the GJX 960. If you had the occasion to participate in the... And it's a blue screen.
So what was the contest about first?
Well, basically, you when you do the live streams, every time there's a blue screen, you get mental. And so the idea was after the ROG camp in Germany, that was already 2 months ago. After that, we had a spare card that we didn't give away during the stream because no one won. Because you had to guess the order of the winners and no one guessed it, right?
Because that changed like 3 minutes before the end.
So everyone was going for the ranking before the end and no one actually changed it. So the card is still there, and so we decided to do that. It's a blue screen contest where people had to make it into in a funny way, etc, etc. So there were quite a few submissions, but two of them really stood out, and because we didn't want it to we wanted to give the prize to one, but the other one is actually something that took quite a lot of effort to do. So I think we want to
make the work that was put into that well deserved. So let's announce the winner first, and then announce the extra winner, that I would say. So the winner gonna win a GTX 960 Strix from ASUS.
Yep.
And the winner is, drum roll,
Mr. Gentleman X.
So congratulations, Mr. Gentleman X, you just won our contest, and it's a blue screen contest, and for the pride and the future, we're gonna watch your video right now. So actually, we should not make not much noise, because the sound on the video is not that much.
Out of the left corner, wearing the red trunks with black and white stripes, with a failure rate of 75% on average, and an occurrence of 5 times per hour, Black Screen. out of the right corner, wearing the blue trunks with red and white stripes, with a failure rate of impressive 100%, and an occurrence of impressive 26 times per hour. And it's a blue screen. Let's get ready to blue screen.
This video is hilarious.
So thank you, Mr. Gentleman X. You just won the 960 Strix edition from Asus in our And It's a Blue Screen contest. We had a lot of fun watching at the video, and to be honest, we're like, okay, this one. That's the funny one. So let's get for this one. So congratulations. I think you won something in the last.
We'll get in touch anyway.
In the live live stream, so we'll get in touch with you to have all the shipping. That was the winner of the 960 Strix. But we wanted to award someone else that did put some effort in making this contest worth it. And we found that was funny too. So
his nickname is RDB_Kato, and he's also one of the very regular on this show or watching the other streams. So he did a complete 3D animation of It's a Blue Screen. So he's using the sound of one of the streams, actually one of the ROG one, I think. And he's just dubbed it on top of this 3D animation. I'm pretty sure he spent quite a lot of time doing it, so it's really worth watching as well.
So let's watch your entry.
It's a blue screen!
This one is hilarious as well.
So yeah, that was the second one we wanted to offer. Sadly, we don't have a second 960 GTX, but we will send you a T-shirt, a CTV T-shirt, and maybe some other stuff we're gonna find in the office if we have
stickers,
stuff like this. So congratulations to you both, Mr. Gentleman X and RGB Kato. You deserve it. That was fun to watch. That was fun for us to also do. We will announce the winners of our next giveaway that finished yesterday in the next few weeks.
Yeah,
days.
No,
actually
maybe,
days.
Maybe not this week. We'll see how.
We'll see
that
after
we
set up the office, to be honest.
Yeah, it's a lot of things to do, but probably by the end of either this week or beginning of next week.
Timothée?
Yes.
If you have to wrap up the show, when that will be?
I would say this is the wrap up. Let's wrap up.
This is awesome.
This is awesome.
Dennis, if you have to sum up this show, what that would be?
Oh, sum up the show. Computex is great and overclocking is better.
Good one. When is the next OC show?
Right, so we're going to record the next OC show next week. So it's going to be out by next Thursday, Friday, something like that.
Good, so 1 week from now, new OC show, 2 weeks from now, the live Q&A.
Yes.
We hope to see you guys there.
Of course, and hopefully we'll be in the
new studio. Don't forget, guys, until then, keep pushing it.
Keep pushing it.